From Crazy Hood Productions, I'm Jay Havana, and this is Family Ties. Today's episode is about Crazy Hood member Eddie Giggs. Eddie's been rocking with hip-hop since he could remember. He implemented his love for the culture into guerrilla marketing and helped spread the Crazy Hood brand throughout the industry. Listen close as he shares his story. From Queens, New York, where he discovered hip-hop, to Kendall, where he would meet EFN and become part of the Crazy Hood family. Always authentic. Always crazy.
Another day, another dollar, my story to tell. Another failed piss test, I'm back to jail. Jail cells overcrowded with killers and thieves. Putting work, motherfuckers, roll up your sleeves. I'm Comptown representer, I'm letting them know. I keep it hood with a nigga, so hand me my dough. I don't play when it comes to bread or the raps. Instead, get the killer motherfucker till his vocals dead. My crazy hood overthrowing, shut up. Nigga, you see the pistol showing from the CPT. Down with EFN between the beef and the peace, local line is still.
Who is Eddie? The person, the individual.
Eddie, who is Eddie? Eddie's a weird guy. He's a shy guy, but funny, and a cool cat. Yeah.
All right. So where are you originally from?
I was born and raised in Queens, New York. I moved out to Miami when I was about 17, but born and raised in Queens. Big up Queens.
Is that the first place where you discovered hip hop?
Yeah, that's definitely the first place I discovered hip hop. Listening from the Public Enemy, KRS-One, you rock him. The crazy thing is, around my neighborhood, I got to see like Kid and Play and Salt and Pepper because they lived around the way, and I see them when I walked around, like coochie rap. So, hip hop was very given to me, like hit me when I was real young.
You mentioned, Public Enemy, Rakim. Who is that one artist when you were younger, when you first discovered hip hop, where it just impacted you and you were like, wow. I love this.
It was definitely Rakim.
Okay.
I guess this is the voice and then just the way he was rhyming. But it was a toss up between him and actually Biz Markie, because he had me laughing.
I can see that. That's cool, though. What are some of the songs that that you first heard from them? Let's go with Rakim first. What's one of the first songs from Rakim that you heard that immediately impacted you?
Immediately impacted me was the pain
of thinking of a master plan. Cause ain't nothing but sweat inside my hand. So I dig into my pocket, all my money spent. So I get deep up, still coming up with lint. So I start
from was just rhyming slow and talking about just getting money and working at it. Like, it was just, to me, that it just hypnotized me, just listening to what he was saying when I was young.
What about with Biz Markie?
Oh, Biz Markie, when I heard Just a Friend, that's it. I was dying. And then seeing the video had me cracking up even more.
Have you ever met a girl that you tried to date, but a year to make love, she wanted you to wait? Let me tell you a story of my situation. I was talking to this girl from the U.S. nation. The way that I met her was on tour at a concert. She had long hair and a short mini skirt. I just got on stage dripping, pouring with sweat. I was walking through the crowd, and guess who I met? I whispered in the air, come to the picture.
So, I mean, I like them from the Vapors and all that, but that song just killed it for me. It just had me dying.
When you were growing up in Queens, you said you used to see Kid and Play and Salt and Pepper. They're from around the way. Like, did you meet them like before they became who they became, or like
never? I never got to meet them. I just like seen them from a distance, and it was crazy that seeing them on videos and on TV, and then you get to see them just walking around the neighborhood.
That's cool.
That was pretty cool.
That's cool.
I never got to meet like any of them personally, like up front and like, yo, what's up? I didn't meet artists until I moved to Miami.
Okay, got you. So talk about a little bit about New York, man. Like, how was it living out there before you moved? And you said 17, right, is when you moved to Miami?
Yeah, at 17, I left New York, moved to Miami. I'm not going to lie. I think I had the best childhood of my life. You know, getting to play in the streets and just the neighborhood environment that I was brought up in. It was cool to actually be there, you know. And then being grown up at the time of hip-hop, and it was just growing as well, I got to get into graffiti, breakdancing, and all that. So, it's crazy. It's like living it and now seeing it on TV, how people like, oh, it's like nostalgic to like see breakdancers and graffitis and stuff like that. So it's real dope to see this twist now that like hip hop is really on the spotlight now. When we was growing up, it was just beginning.
Did you actually, when you did the graffiti, did you go by a certain name?
Yeah. I'm Key One. In my house, they call me Kiko.
Oh, okay.
And then my boys around the neighborhood, they didn't want to call me Kiko, so they just called me Key for short. I was like, yo, Key. And then I just stuck with Key One.
How about breakdancing? Did you do it all from the pop locking to the gyros to everything?
Man, I did the backspin and all that, but as when you get that age and if you're really not a breaker, you definitely not going to keep on doing it. And then once you try to do it again, you're going to bust your ass. So when I was 10, 11, it was cool. After that, I couldn't do it no more.
Did you ever like do like any type of like rapping, producing, singing?
Nah, I'm be honest. I didn't do none of that until I moved to, you know, Miami and met the crew and started getting into the music more. But I was a vandal. I got up in New York. I was a graffiti dude. I was just getting up and doing throw ups. I wasn't a piecer. I was getting around. But other than that, I just listened to music while I was out there, doing stupid shit. But other than that, until I moved here is when I said I got into the music heavy.
Let's fast forward a little bit. So at 17 years old, you moved to Miami. Explain that transition.
It was kind of like bittersweet in a sense, because I didn't want to leave New York, but then coming out here was a whole different look, and the weather was fantastic, so I'm not going to complain about that. But it was like really, really different, because coming from New York in the city, taking trains and buses and getting around without a car, to moving to Miami where you need a car and you can't really get around the trains and buses, it was a big culture shock in a sense.
Right.
But I'm not going to lie, it was a dope move, because I got to meet the craziest, illest, dope friends of my whole life.
So you came out here, you're adjusting to the whole culture of it, way different than New York. Around what time or around what year would you say where you met the whole Crazy Hood family?
I would say like 93, pretty much. The beginning of 93, because I moved out here at the end of the 92. It's crazy, because I was in environmental science class, and EFN happened to be in the same class. And I had a Source magazine with me. So, you know, as I was saying, I wasn't paying attention to school, so I'm up in my Source magazine.
Right.
Looking at reading information, and then he looked over and he saw that I had it. He was like, oh shit, yo, can I get, because it was hard to get out here.
Yeah.
So he was like, yo, can I check it? And then, yeah, I was like, no problem. And then ever since then, like, you know, he knew I was into hip hop, so we was cool from there.
What were some of like the artists that you guys had in common?
All right. It wasn't that in depth when I like linked up with E, because he already had his group of friends, and I was just meeting new people from moving out here.
Gotcha.
So we didn't really get into too much talk about hip hop then. How I really got, like, I mean, we, at the end of the day, in high school, we all hung out with almost the same crowd of people. We just different cliques. You understand?
Yeah.
But we all like still knew each other. So like, I knew of EFN or E and Heckler and all these other niggas. There was Heckler and all these other, and Heckler was in a whole other crew. Drain was in a whole other crew. And then E had made up a crew with I think it was Thoughts and Oso and them. And then I was with some Dominican crazy cats from New York. but we all knew each other. And then it was with a girlfriend I had that she, well, at least I thought she could sing. Well, she had a good voice. And I remember that, and this is after high school when we all got out. You know what I'm saying? When we got out is when pretty much E had put Crazy Hit together.
Okay.
And I came in the sense that I knew everybody. My girl could sing. And I said, all right, these niggas is doing me, you know, music. Let me see if I can get her on. Maybe, you know, some shit could pop off.
For sure.
And brought her through and this and that. Everybody knew her, too, because she was in school. But, you know, she did a little something for the mixtape. And then I asked E if I could, you know, I said, yo, I want to be down with this shit, you know. Like, can I get in and, you know, can I be down? And he was like, yeah. And ever since then, we've been stuck.
That's tight. Were you initially part of the whole How Can I Be Down music conference?
Yeah. I was definitely there.
Explain those. Like, how do you, what was your experience going to those?
It was crazy because seeing Miami the way it was nice, cool, calm, and this and that, and then all of a sudden you get this hip hop convention out here, and then the streets was in Miami Beach. You see poster boards all over the place, stickers, and then just seeing rappers just walking around just like nothing. Like, it was crazy. It was a dope time. I ain't gonna front. Like, those conferences, it was more personal because you had to go up to these rappers or producers and introduce yourself and what you're doing and how can you get plugged in to make it. You know what I'm saying? It's not like social media now. It's just send emails and messages and shit.
Right.
It was more personal then.
Were you more like attracted to like the networking and kind of like a management type of role?
Yes. I wasn't very strong at it.
Okay.
It was crazy. I at the end of the day, I'm like more like Eddie No Gigs, because I ain't never got these nigga No Gigs. He was the one I got it with. But, you know, I was there on the streets. I was just, at the end of the day, I was more marketing and promotion, and I ended up that route because I just like hitting the streets. I like being that vandal nigga.
How did you get the name Gigs?
Well, there you go. I wanted to be the management. I think it was E that made up their name or whatever. He said, yeah, Eddie Gigs, blah, blah, blah. And I never got these niggas a fucking gig, so. the name stuck with me, and I'm Gigs.
That is dope. You love the marketing and promotion side of everything. Is that?
I like the guerrilla marketing.
The guerrilla marketing.
Let me make it specific. Give it the right definition of what I mean. Email blasting and stuff like that is cool. I'd rather hit the streets.
Yes. Can you go into that a little bit, bro? Like, to talk a little bit about the element behind it, like what you have to do to really get out there and put the word out, and any like tactics that you used.
I mean, it's a different time now. It's so different now. Like, the methods that you use now, pretty much you cover more ground than.
Back then.
But
yeah,
if you want to make a local impression in your, you know, where you live, to make sure that people know about you, then yeah, I think that's the best thing you should do is be on the streets, get your posters up in every corner, put some stickers around, make sure all the little bodegas got your CD up in there so people can get it. Yeah, you know, stuff like that for your neighbor. Yeah, and then add up all the Facebooks and Instagrams and all that Snapchatty, all that. And then you can cover the world.
Do you feel like being able to do that, being able to be networking with people at these businesses that you put the posters up, the people walking on the streets, giving them flyers or them seeing the posters that you're putting up, you feel like that was a time where like you could really, really connect with people?
Yeah, because, you know, most people, they see you doing that, and they walk them out, and they're like, hey, yo, what's that? Then you can give them the information yourself, and if you have a CD on your hand, you give it to them. You know, like, it's just, you're more personal with your fans. Like, they get to see you and see what you're doing, or the people that rep you, you know?
Yeah.
Regardless, get the team. So, you know, it's just dope to just actually talk to your fans and talk to people that admire whatever you're doing.
Yeah.
And, yeah.
And also,
that's
you...
Amazing.
Go ahead.
No, go ahead.
No, you go.
I forgot what I was going to say.
This guy. No, I was going to say, too, like, also, like, you get to show your personality, you know, whether you're, like, the artist or, you know, you're in the marketing and promotions, you know? Everybody has that personality where they could just have the opportunity to shine.
Exactly. So, I mean, you know, at the end of the day, you got to be that people person, too.
Yes.
If you're not, don't get into marketing. You're not going to like it.
Were you there at the beginning of when Crazy Hood was formed, or did you come on like a little bit after it was formed?
It was formed before we got out of high school.
Okay.
It was formed. You know, that was East Crew that he made in school.
Right.
And then right after, I knew they was doing music. So it was like, yeah, I was pretty much there from the beginning, but not from the beginning. Yeah, I was saying, Weird Thoughts is the Crazy Hood historian. Any question you want to know about Crazy Hood, you ask that man right there.
The Crazy Hood historian.
Yes, that's facts. He knows everything. He might slip up on a few things, but the majority of the history, he knows.
Okay, so to get kind of like a timeline, were you part of the Crazy Good store?
Yeah, actually, it was me and EFN that put that store together.
Can you talk about that a little bit?
Well, it was hard to get like real like hip hop clothing out here in Miami. It was very hard. Not too many stores at it. So, plus we lived in Kendall, which is like 20, 30 minutes away from, no, I'm gonna say 20 minutes away from like downtown and maybe 25 minutes from the beach. So that's the only place you can go get like some fresh gear. So we wanted to bring it to Kendall. And we said, yo, let's put a store together, blah, blah, blah. We just brainstorm. His father's a businessman, so he helped us get the spot and get everything going. But that, let me tell you, that's a hard business right there.
Right.
Anybody thinking about getting that, you better have good capital, motherfuckers.
So at that store, was it kind of like every brand of clothing that you guys sold?
Yeah, pretty much from that era. We had Wu Wei, we had RP55, we had Notorious Gear, we had our own, obviously. But what else? I mean, shit. D-Lo, Echo. I mean, we carried all the brands, and we sold the magazine Source, mixed. We sold everybody's mixtapes. We sold vinyl there too.
Oh wow!
Yeah, no, it was a good little run. The thing is, it was hard. I bowed out earlier. That shit was too crazy. It was just a lot of. Too much, and I was young. I didn't know how to handle it, so I bowed out.
Gotcha.
And it is what it is. But that was we had a great experience for the time that we were doing.
Right. Okay. From Crazy Goods, did that lead into the CHP marketing, like the marketing team and all that?
Yes, pretty much. Right after Crazy Goods, during the ending of Crazy Goods,
okay.
He started talking to people that was dealing with accounts with record labels, and he just knocked out a couple, and we started Crazy Hood Marketing from there.
Talk a little bit about the Crazy Hood Marketing. I know you spoke about the Guerrilla Marketing a little bit, but talk about How was the experience working with these accounts?
Shit, we worked pretty much all the labels you could imagine. Capitol, Interscope, Def Jam, Columbia, Atlantic. Well, we did them all. We did them all. And from movies to clothing companies, too, we promoted for Echo. We did such a good job for Echo, we gave them $1 million fine.
Whoa.
And we shut down all the street teams.
How'd you guys give them $1 million fine?
How we do it. We stick it up, South Beach, post it up, stenciled up. I mean, we destroyed it. South Beach was Echo. Echoville, like you just saw everything echo everywhere.
Wow,
we killed it for that. Yeah, now it was. Let me tell you that was the best time. I'm not gonna lie, I was a little lazy on a lot of projects. Mm-hmm. I was tired. It's stressful hitting the street, putting up poster board stickers, talking to people. Hey, come on, see this, take pictures, hold us up.
Right.
It got a little stressful, but I got to meet pretty much all the tastemakers in Miami at that time.
Hmm. How was that, like, networking with them?
You know, some were little bitches and some were real.
Right.
But at the end of the day, just there's dope that you got to get. It's just so different now. You don't see that no more. You don't see street team. I mean, the only people that you see right now that actually getting it are like the people that just breaking records and are going straight to the radio and making things happen. Like, that's the quickest way now. To me, that's like the new era of guerrilla marketing. Like, you just get this one person and they're just going to these stations that got to connect and breaking records.
Right.
Like, there's no more putting up poster boards and letting people know or go out there, oh shit, new album coming out. So different now. Back then it was since I was a graffiti dude, I loved doing the whole sniping and everything. So that was like, it made my night.
What was that? The whole what?
Sniping, putting up the poster boards on like the street lights.
Uh-huh.
Putting them up all the way to the top. We totem pole them. It was just dope seeing blocks, especially during like the How Can I Be Down convention and stuff. Mm-hmm. When all the street teams from all the different markets will come down and they just destroy South Beach. Like, it just looks so like urban. Like you go now, it's like it looks pretty, so nice and clean.
Mm-hmm.
Back then, that thing was just crazy, stickers everywhere. That's why they shut it down. I'm surprised Revolt is still doing, like, getting a chance to do a conference.
Right.
Hey, fuck the beach up. Well, we fucked the beach up.
That's dope, man. What are some of the other things that you miss about the guerrilla marketing?
I mean, it's just being on the streets doing that. I mean, me and now as an older guy, I wouldn't do it no more. Like, that shit, just talking about it made me tired. But yeah, just thinking about it, like, it was just long nights. And long days and hardly any sleep, but it was just as a young dude, like in the hip hop culture, because I'm not just, I don't like hip hop, I am hip hop. So like, just living it and doing all of that shit gave me a dope feeling, just being a part of that whole movement.
Right. What does loyalty mean to you?
Loyalty from the get, I don't need to know nothing else about you.
Right. Right.
That's 100.
Yeah. How is it to see it firsthand, where you guys started as like a crew and you developed it into the Crazy Goods? You developed it into the marketing. You developed that into like the Drink Champs, and it goes into 25 years together, you know. And even before the 25 years, the music, you know what I mean, the bond, the friendships that you guys built, how is it living through that, through your eyes?
I mean it's hard to explain. You just saying that brought everything, like, it's real flashbacks in my head right now. And to see the progression is incredible. I'm so proud of everybody that's a part of it, because it was a whole team effort. You know, if it wasn't for all of us being that team, it wouldn't have got to where it is right now.
Mm-hmm.
And I strongly believe that, because you got to work hard at anything in life. You know, you want to be a doctor, you got to work hard at being a doctor to be that best doctor.
Right.
You want to be a garbage man, you're going to be the best garbage man and clean up the block quick. So we try to do the best we can and work hard at it and be honest. Because this game is a lot of bullshitters.
Right.
We try to be, surround ourselves with honest people in the industry. It might have taken us 25 years to get some type of recognition, but at the end of the day, you got to be persistent and keep working hard, and it'll eventually get there. And we just touching the, like, we right there, just touching the, our toes just in the water right now.
Right.
You know, we do Coming Home, the documentaries. That's another big thing that he brainstormed and put together, and doing real good. So we doing music, movies, and we can still get down in the marketing, you know.
We've laid the foundation for a new creation of sound, headed southbound, I-95, connect the cable drive, 88 the birthplace, where we create the foundation, the foundation, the foundation.
What you see here is pioneers of down south rap, my team rock with the force of 1,000 gun claps. Remember that we made it possible, niggas on the corner, we probable this shit while you ducks was Pop Warner. Don't fuck around with law and order, I thought you heard, we getting what we deserve, and that's more than just words. The smart they learned the first time when I drop rhyme and break the fuck out of dot. On the drop of a dime, it's all fine. My thoughts in crime, well, they combine. When I rep 305, son, I laze it on the line. I'm never outshine. First come, first get served.
There's a lot of things that we've done, and it's dope to see how it's gotten right now. So, you know, we're seeing the work pay off right now.
Yes. How is it seeing your friend EFN go from having that vision of Crazy Hood to taking it to where it is right now? How is it seeing him firsthand do that?
I mean, it's dope, number one, but I think it's long overdue. This like the ideas, the ways of getting things done and doing shit, like, I think it should have been and been out a long time ago, but that's, you know, it is what it is. But yeah, no, I'm proud, I'm honored, and happy to see that everything that he wanted to put together and make happen. Like, it's real dope. I don't know how to explain it. It's crazy to explain it, because it's like we just feel so humble. It's like it's my brother. It's just happening. Like, it's just business, like normal day.
Right. You know.
But you just feel happy that this is good, you know, like everyone's good.
Right. When you first heard Biz Markie and Rakim and Public Enemy, KRS-One, right? When you first heard them, did you ever think, like, man, I would one day have that opportunity to meet them? Or even if you didn't meet them, meet people who create hip hop that you've loved and enjoyed over the years, and be a part of that culture?
No, I've been blessed that I got to meet every last one of them that I mentioned. And it's close to them, you know?
Right.
And to be, like, super close, and that some of them even know EFN, like, just, and they even call them on the reg, like, dude, I had Jerobi in front of my friend smoking. Like, I'm speechless. I don't even know what to say. It's dope. It's a dope feeling.
Yes. Yeah. Can you, like, name, like, one of the, I'm going to say it, like, as a fan perspective, one of the coolest moments where that you experienced with, like, someone that you've looked up to, as far as, like, musically and been a fan of their craft?
I mean, I had the dopest year being Nori's roommate.
Gotcha.
You know what I'm saying? When he moved out here to Miami, I was his roommate for the whole year. Like, that was, you know, we was playing his mixtapes and Crazy Goods, you know, like, you know, hearing all the music back then, and to be living with him and chilling with him and going out eating it, like, that's, I'm telling you, I'm good, like, and I don't got pictures, and I'm not that dude to take pictures with everybody and selfies and this and that. I'm just not that guy. I've never been that person.
Yeah.
I'm not saying that it's a bad thing. I think everybody should document their time on this planet with whoever they love. You know what I'm saying? That's
right.
That's dope. I just don't do it. You know, I'm not that. If it's a girl with a big butt, I'm going to take a picture with her. But, you know, I'm not really big into, you know, doing that. But, I forgot what the hell was I talking about. The big butt just threw me off.
You were talking. I asked you, like, how is it to? Well, you were talking about you and Nori being part of, being roommates.
Being living with him for a year. Yeah, like that was just. It's dope listening to him being a fan. The whole, you know, war report, all this shit was crazy, and boom, I'm living with this nigga.
Right.
That was dope.
Right. All right, just to go back on the ass part, since, you know, they gave you that nickname, the ass eater, right?
Yeah, I see, that's the thing. You can't tell your friends everything.
Right.
You know, once you tell your friends, yeah, yo, y'all ate this girl ass out. You eat ass. Oh, that's it. Everybody, yeah, Eddie, that eat that.
And the name was born.
And the name was born. And, you know, hey, listen, I like to do that to women. As long as they can, we good.
All right. On a more serious note, what does crazy hood mean to you?
It's brotherhood, loyalty. I don't know what it, like that. That's pretty much what sums it up, man. Like, it's just, these are my brothers. Like, being around them their whole lives and living their lives as much as I live my own, like, it's crazy.
Right.
So yeah, that's brotherhood.
What are your future goals?
Man, I don't know, dog. That's a good question, and I'm stupid old, and that's a good question. Just try to be the best person that I could be, man. Right now, I'm just working, and trying to go pop. I got some plans up my sleeve. It's in the works. Like I said, you gotta be patient.
For sure.
But for right now, you know, the team is shining. The team is good. As long as the team is good, I'm good.
Good.
The future is endless. I could do whatever right now.
Yeah, that's true. Very true. You know? Yes, sir.
So, the main thing is just keep being loyal, keep being honest to my niggas, and keep working hard at whatever we doing. And my future will be bright. Believe that.
In our next episode, we meet another member of the Crazy Hood family, Heckler, an ill MC who's originally from Chicago, This underworld element developed his love for rhyming and used it when forming the Alliance. Tune in and listen to his story. New episodes of Family Ties come out weekly. Family Ties is a Crazy Hood Productions. This episode was produced by DJ EFN and myself, Jay Havana. Our theme music is titled Southwest by DJ EFN, featuring MC8, Blue, and Cam, with production by The Guild. If you like what we're doing, please rate and review us on Apple Podcasts. It helps new people find out about the show. Also, check us out on Audio Boom and CrazyHood.com. Always authentic, always crazy.